A walk through the streets of Gaza town, one will surely appreciate how Uganda is endowed with various foodstuffs. Despite the uncertainties created by COVID-19, farmers have continued to supply foodstuff to the market, though prices are slowly rising again. But away from the busy streets, we discover that not everyone here can access and afford the foods sold. In this slum of Chimwanyi is where we found Ewan Nampija Goret, who has been for 3 years bedridden with no clear future of recovery. She says to date she does not know what she is suffering from, but her interest was immediately shifted to how and what she is eating. She says her family has not had a decent meal since she fell sick, and this has been worsened by the COVID-19 pandemic. Unfortunately, she is unable to work, and now it's her nephew supporting the family. She was a bit lucky that her family was introduced to Center for Food and Adequate Living Rights operating in Gaza.
I'm Kasima Janet, a lawyer working with SafeRoot, Center for Food and Adequate Living Rights, as the program head, advocacy and campaigns. We conducted a research in Kamwanyi village in Gayaza in July of this year.
The NGO conducted a survey which showed that more people in the area were prone to poverty.
Our findings, we found out that majority of people in Kamwanyi village do not have food. Most of them were staying days without getting any food, some having one meal a day, others only giving food to children like porridge at lunch and no supper or no breakfast.
As Uganda will join the rest of the world tomorrow to mark World Food Day, data from Sauti za Wananchi shows that the state of food security is alarming. In May to June this year, in comparison to the previous month, 6 out of 10 Ugandan households reported their food consumption got worse. Rural households, which is about 63%, poorer households, 72%, and those with low levels of education, which is 64%, were more likely to face increasing food challenges. At the same time, 2 out of 10 of households, which is 18%, reported better food consumption than the previous month, while 47% of Ugandan households depend on agriculture to survive in urban areas. People depend equally on crop farming and casual labor for their income.
All right, very good morning once again, and thanks so very much for keeping it Urban TV. My name is Henry Sekanjak. Of course, we're coming to this second and last segment of Urban Today. And of course, as you already tomorrow, Uganda will be joining the rest of the world to celebrate the World Food Day. And of course, the main celebrations will take place at State House in Tebe. And our theme is Grow, Nutrition, Sustain Together, Our Actions, Our Future. And of course, we know that there's a recent report, and that's according to the World Food Program, a report that was released in this very year, about 1.5 million people in Uganda are food insecure, and 3.8 million Ugandans, of course, require food security, life foods and nutrition. And of course, as you already know, that you know, in a COVID situation, but you know, food rights activists, of course, have been raising concerns that as government, you know, nothing much has been done, of course, to address the issue of nutrition. And of course, to discuss this and more, I've been joined by Mr. David Kabanda. He's the executive director of the Center for Food and Adequate Living Rights. Good morning, David.
Good morning.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Tomorrow is, you know, World Food Day. Mm. And let's talk about it.
Tomorrow, Uganda is going to be joining the world to commemorate food. You see, when you talk about food, many people think, don't even, you know, stop to feminate to think about this important aspect of our lives. But I want to remind Ugandans that every person, the moment they wake up, the first thing they think about is, what am I going to eat today? But we are in a situation this year, the International World Food Day is coming in at a time when we have suffered COVID-19. And many grave disruptions have happened in communities. Social cohesion is no longer there, and many people are really struggling to come back to ground. So this has caused too many issues concerning food availability, food accessibility, and food affordability.
Yeah.
Many people are food insecure, and many people are suffering critical food insecurity, and people are silently dying of hunger. And we have now come out to speak for people who cannot come up, you know, to speak. Many people are sick. Some of these people are chronically sick, others are on medicines, and they can't access food. So we have these issues, and one of the critical components that we are promoting and encouraging government to do is to establish national food reserves. You realize that this is a constitutional obligation on the part of government, but it was abandoned completely. Right. It is in the constitution since 1995, but government has not. So we think that if government came up and put up national food reserves, we will have less problems of people who are dying of hunger. Let me tell you, if government just put up national food reserves, functional food reserves, we would have less of these problems and would cut back on the expenditure on health. Because if people eat well, if people are well nourished, then they will not have too many illnesses that come because of poor nutrition. We are talking about people who cannot afford food, and what 39% of Uganda's children are malnourished.
That's true.
Now, what kind of population is that? How are we going to live, you know, in the near future if the biggest population you have is malnourished? They cannot then have the capacity to serve themselves and to serve the nation. So we continuously are asking government, can you please make interventions? And another thing that we always come back and speak to government about is, can we have a human rights-based approach? Because the moment you talk about food, many people brush it off as an individual responsibility. Yes, we don't mean that government should come and give us food portions but there must be a system, because when you're talking about the right to food, we mean the food must be available in terms of facilitating food production. Because when you look at the World Food Day this year, it's talking about growth, you understand?
Yes, true.
But how do you sustainably grow food? Mm-hmm. Recently, we were very happy when government came up with the organic agriculture policy.
Yeah.
If they implement it, we think that many people could be able to get safe food. But availability also has another aspect of, is food available in the markets? Is food available in shops? One of the ironies we have around food is, the problem is that the problem is not about us not having food. We actually have enough food in Uganda. You understand?
But what's the problem?
But people can't get this food. For example, in the month of July and August, in Isingiro, you could get a very big bunch of matoke at 2,000. Other people were even cutting it to just leave it in the garden. But in Kampala here, you would find that to buy that bunch of matoke, you needed 20,000. You understand? Mm. So government must put in an effort to have food into caste where there is no food, to facilitate this movement of food.
Because, okay, David, before we dive into, food security and all that,
yeah,
there's an issue on, a concern that government has not given priority, to nutrition.
Yeah.
Especially during this period of COVID,
mm-hmm.
People are eating anyhow.
Yeah.
Yet, nutrition should have been one of those major concerns,
mm-hmm.
where they preach about, eating right, because there's a belief that, when you eat certain foods, you build your immunity.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about this as well.
Okay. You see, the moment we talk about food, people must understand it in two dimensions. One is food security, but also food safety. Because someone can just eat to fill up the stomach, but they've eaten nothing, or they have even eaten death.
Yeah.
You understand? It's because what you are is what you ate today or yesterday. So during lockdown, we saw how government was stripped naked on its promises and its, I don't want to call it incompetency, but for lack of a better word, on making sure that people eat safe. Because much of the food that was given to people was contaminated. That is number one. But another aspect that we need to look at, even beyond...
Contaminated, what do you mean?
The food was contaminated with aflatoxins. You see, aflatoxins are molds. You see, they may have procured it from sources that never stored it well.
Mm.
And we also encourage Ugandans, if you store food in your own house, make sure that food is stored in a dry, clean place. Because if you have flour, for example, if you have maize, even dry cassava, it has a tendency of developing the molds, and then they kill people. Recently, you heard about food that was supplied in Karamoja, and people died because the food was contaminated with aflatoxins and other foreign materials like glass, like metal, and microbial organisms in food. So how can government set out to give food to its people? And the government body, Uganda National Bureau of Standards, came out and said 38% of the food that was given to people was contaminated, you understand? And they told government, please recall the food. But the government never recalled the food. People ate it. So we don't know whether people died, and maybe government should even make an audit to find out who died, who didn't, and who are those people that are going on with, morbidities because of that food. But another aspect related to that, beyond just government giving out contaminated food, is the food industry or the trade in food. This is an area that government has completely neglected or failed to regulate. Let me tell you, when the strict lockdown rules were released, many people went to supermarkets, many people went to shops, but these shops and the trading center, places had all the stock, and they just sold it. Me, myself, I bought water, because I wanted to see what is happening in the market. And they were expired. Do you know Ugandans don't know that water expire? They think that if you get a water bottle, even the elite, even those people who you think they know, we have a lot of work to do when it comes to food literacy in this country. Let me tell you, Ugandans, food, everything that you put in your mouth expires. The water, before you buy that bottle of water, check the expiry date. And when it comes to these other items, the food items, please don't pick the overly processed foods. And even you, when you decide to pick them, try to look at the nutrition labeling. We want to ask government that many of these products which are in the supermarket, which are in shops, which are imported, are not properly labeled. What we want to encourage government to do is, and UNBS, can we have the front of the pack labeling and warning that in this product, we have this content of sugar, for example.
Maybe government is not aware of some of the things and is civil society. What have you done about it to sensitize people about the kind of foods they should eat and then the things that they should look out for, not to be poisoned? Because we have gotten many cases of food poisoning in the country.
Yeah. We do too many things as civil society. Mm. One of the things that we do is here. I'm here. Instead of being in my bed, I'm here to speak to the nation and to speak to duty bearers. That is number one. Mm. Number two, we have done research, which we have shared with government over these issues. Number four, beyond just engaging government in parliament and also in maybe cabinet, we have even gone to court. We recently filed a suit trying to ask government to regulate marketing of unhealthy foods to children. Mm. Do you know that 38% of children in Uganda are suffering from obesity?
You because understand? They're eating pizza.
Yes. You just read the statistics from the Cancer Institute. Mm. We have a very big trend growing of children having stomach cancers. You go and find out, many children are now diabetic. Children are developing unusual pressures, and it is coming from the food. The junk food market is not regulated. We went to court to specifically ask the government, can you please regulate the advertisement? And you see, the advertisement is very aggressive, that it even goes to schools. Mm. They organize tournaments, and children are hooked onto sugar-sweetened beverages. And because they are children, they haven't reached the age of reason where they can understand the commercial intent of these food industries.
But David, one would say that it's not a responsibility of government, because it's the parents, you, who buy these foods for these children. However much the industry is regulated, parents will go ahead and buy these foods for their children. So yeah, I think it's the parents who blame for this.
Okay, that is also very true. But you see, we have three obligations when it comes to human rights. Mm. We have the obligation to protect. Government, under Article 20 of the Constitution, must protect the old, the young, the aged, everyone. So government must protect people from the vested interests of the food industry. That is number one. Number two is respect. And number three is fulfill the rights to food. Yes, we know that parents have a role to play. And even under the Constitution and the Children's Act, parents have the legal obligation to protect children. And our organization, by the way, has started also doing research. We are going to sue individual parents of children having obesity. Sincerely. Yeah, because you leave your children. You see, in Uganda, if a person defiled a child, we will all go and arrest, or if a parent killed a child, can we leave them? Or if the parent tortured a child, can we leave them? We don't. Why do we leave them when they subject children to unhealthy foods that is going to kill them? Mm. So the issue, but another issue, let me tell you, also parents, many parents don't know. Some parents are as ignorant as their children. And you see why food industry targets children is because of the pester power syndrome. Have you heard about pester power? That the moment you have a child with you, and maybe it's your biological child, and they look for something and they want it, they pester you to buy it. Mm. In most cases, you'll go under the pressure and then buy it. Have you ever been in maybe a taxi or in a taxi park and the children start crying at hawkers, the commodities?
They want to see a cake and then they want to have it. Cake.
And the hawkers also know. They will bring the cake near the child such that the child cries. So it happens, and the industry, the food industry knows this. Now, because the food industry is interested in making profits, it should be the role of government to come in and try to protect the innocent. Because if you have a child and you're a parent, you'll tell the child that, you see, you are crying for that, but it is not right for you to eat. It's not good for you. So you shouldn't eat it.
All right, going back to the issue of COVID and food, I remember through your, you know, different CSOs on food rights, petition the president about a government's neglect to sensitize Ugandans on the right food to eat during this COVID. How far have you gone? Did you get a response?
No, we haven't got a response. But first of all, we want to acknowledge. You see, it is not also good to only speak negatives. We want to acknowledge government because in all the directives that the government came up with, the president made, everywhere you find that he talks about food. Where we are not happy is for him to pick posho and he starts slicing it as if that is a complete meal. From the head of state, that is not what we expected from government. We expected at least to have a demonstration of a balanced diet. That is number one. We wrote a petition to the office of the Prime Minister because it is the coordinating office. Up to now, we have never got a response. But I know, they know all these issues. We don't have a food authority in this country, and that is alarming. Why shouldn't we? We must have a food authority in this country. And another thing that I want to tell you between food, trade, and nutrition. The many proteins we get is from animals, then the poultry. But who regulates the production at that level? No one. You may find I'm a farmer, I have my 100 broilers, I wouldn't want to even engage a veterinary officer, and I injected drugs in these birds. With the egg production, the same issue. So you find that everyone is now hooked up in eating things that eventually will kill us. I want to appeal to all of you Ugandans who care. Some Ugandans don't care, but better know that the premature death is on your doorstep if we continue with the lifestyle of just eating whatever we find. We have continuously asked government that not everyone should cook, you understand? Because it's very difficult for everyone to cook their food, for everyone to go back home and eat. Where we work, where we go to markets, and maybe these people are on borders, you now see that many people have food stores, the street eating. All that must also be checked. The local governments, instead of only looking up for trade licenses, they must also have public health specialists. When you enter a restaurant, you ask for maybe fish or you ask for beef, they always bring something which looks like soup. And many people like it when it is thick. Who made it thick? What made it thick? What do you think is in there? You take that test and be very careful when you go back home. You'll find there is a weird test. You understand? And you know what they do? There are too many chemicals that these restaurants and even street foods put in your food. You buy and eat.
Yeah, David, I'll take you back to the issue of food insecurity in the country. Of course, there's a recent report on food security status. It was a food security status report. And of course, they were looking at the effects of COVID. And this report says that about 70% of Ugandans living in Kampala are facing acute food insecurity. And of course, they're saying that in July, six in 10 families sold their, you know, productive assets such as land and livestock. to look for food. And of course, we all know that Uganda is a food basket. We have lots and lots of food in the country. But then, you know, we find ourselves, you know, facing food insecurity. What is the problem?
The problem is in two ways. The first is at individual level. Because although we are asking government to help us with systems and everything, but individual people must also know that they are responsible in trying to make sure that they have food. But they, although we talk about individual responsibility, for which we do not want anyone to run away from, there is a lot of commercialization when it comes to food production. Actually, government right now should not be sleeping. All Kampala people should actually be on the streets. If you have 70% of your population in acute, you know, food insecurity, then you have all the causes to worry. All is not well. What government or what happened? What went wrong? When we got the lockdown, government did not prioritize on urban farming. Government did not prioritize on how the small-scale farmers back in our gardens should thrive. Although they said that the shops should stay open, but the transport was down. So my mother down in the village, who depends on me to get inputs, couldn't, because I was locked in my house. She couldn't come to town. And also the shops in their townships were also what? Closed. So what ought to have happened was government ought to have come up with a robust kind of response in terms of inputs. For example, right now many people do not have seeds. You understand?
But the government has been, you know, promoting that program of giving out seedlings to different other than that's program.
What are they giving out? Seeds. You'll find that they are giving out citruses, lemon, and that is not food. What we want are seeds. And what happened to our community seed systems? You see, it is not proper. Government, and I'm not particularly saying that this government, no. I'm talking about the state called Uganda. I think whoever is in the management of this state must understand that not everything must be left to individuals. COVID-19 has taught us that our models of development are very wrong. If you base on privatization, everything should, you know, it is less fair. It is completely illogical, because we have eventually now learned that we need a collective effort. And this is why the International Food World Food Day theme is talking about collective action. We all need to be engaged. Me at an individual level, you, Mr. Government, because you can forecast, you have the resources. Can we look into issues of land? You understand? Issues of seed, issues of input. Another thing is, you see, food production is a science, whether we like it or not. Because someone might say, ah, but of course we have these rural people. Where do they get the science? That same knowledge they have as traditional knowledge, it is a science. My mother has a way of mulching the garden and everything. It is a science. The missing link is extension services.
All right. Okay, you're still watching Urban Today. My name is Henry Sekanjaka, and of course in the studio is David Kabanda, is the Executive Director, Center for Food and Adequate Living Rights. We're talking about the World Food Day. Uganda will be joining the rest of the world tomorrow to celebrate this day under the theme, Grow Nutrition, Sustain Together, our Action, Our Future. And of course, so you can join us on our socials, that's Urban Television on Facebook, Urban TV Uganda on Twitter, Seka Henry on Facebook, Seka Henry on Twitter, Lynn Komjisha on Facebook, and Lynn UG3 on Twitter, and share your thoughts on how we can protect ourselves from food insecurity as a country. And of course, David, I'll be coming back to you, you know, and, you know, to ask you to share your thoughts with us on how what you think we can do as a country to ensure that you know we have enough food that we can feed on as a country, as Ugandans.
Thank you very much. And for us who are into food, health food promotion, there are four things that we need to do. The first one, of course, it feeds into others, is government should now embrace a human rights-based approach to food. Because a human rights-based approach requires four elements to be in place. One, that the food is available. That means that the government must put in efforts to make sure that the food is produced. The second one is that the food is accessible. Accessible to everyone, whether as a child, whether as a man, whether as a male, whether as people, you know, who are in the community. Food must be accessible. And food must be affordable. Government must make sure that, like, you can pick lessons from other countries, like in India. You see, we have public schools and private schools. We have public hospitals and private hospitals. In every sector, you'll find that government at least puts up a system where those people who can't afford can at least get a fee or a service from government. Why is it too difficult, Mr. Government, for you to establish food stores where poor people can access food at lower prices? And you can now, you know, regulate, and people know that the moment you pick food from that store, for example, let me give you a very simple example of posho. The posho that Ugandans are eating is dangerous. First, the way it is milled, because many millers don't have food grade machines, and we eat metal. You understand? Just imagine eating metal on a daily basis and in all our schools. You understand? So maybe government should have like a milling plant where they do milling with whole fiber. Because what we eat right now, there is no fiber. And we have been talking to government over this over again, and we want to repeat it, that it is possible. And in extreme cases of people like that lady in Kamwanyi, who is crippled, and you have now these children who are tending, taking care of this woman, can we give them coupons where they can access food? Because the challenge is not about food in this country. The challenge is how can people access it? If you've not put up a system to help people access the food, then there's a problem.
Now,
the fourth thing under human rights-based approach is sustainability. Is it sustainable? Make sure that this is sustainable. And I wanted to also expound on the second one, beyond the human rights-based approach, but of course they all feed into this, is extension services.
What do you mean by extension
services? Extension services are the agriculturalists. The people, these officers at sub-county level, parish level. I understand that government came up with a scheme of having a model farmer per parish. But you see, I'm an individual. I'll not be there to teach everyone. There is a promise that government made that by 2018, they must have reached a certain number of extension workers to come to people and explain. This is what I was talking about, that growing food is a science. Post-harvest handling is another science. We have too many losses that we make as farmers. You understand? There must be people to train and keep with the farmers such that we do not have losses. And the last thing is, government cannot continuously running away. They cannot run away from the obligation of establishing a functional, effective food reserve system in the country.
Right. Yeah, there's also another concern on the issue of mechanization of agriculture.
Yeah.
People are saying that, you know, as a country we are facing food insecurity because government has not, you know, done enough to mechanize agriculture. People are still using those rudimentary methods to, you know, to farm. And then also the issue of land. People are saying that there's not enough land for people to engage in agricultural practices. What's your comment on this?
That is not true. Those two things are not true. Let me tell you, 80% of food production is done by small-scale farmers. You see, there is this kind of conversation that the industry wants to bring up that mechanize, use fertilizers, use chemicals. You know, we must go away from that. If the small-scale farmers are facilitated well, they can grow enough food because they are already feeding 80% of the population. You understand? In Uganda here, we only have 1.8 usage of maybe inputs, those fertilizers. What needs to be done is government to get out of its comfort zone.
Sure.
And they work with the individual community members who grow food to make sure that the food production is sustainable. Work with the farmers. Let me tell you, we have some people who grow food organically in Uganda, and it is only for export. It's as if Ugandans are not human beings to eat good food. If it is going to EU market, USA, then the food is produced organically, and it goes outside the country. When it comes to your country, all markets, do you know that 90% of the food in many markets in Uganda is contaminated with chemicals, chemical residues, beyond the threshold set by World Health Organization? And some of these chemicals have been banned elsewhere in the world, including glyphosate, paraquat. But what is happening is no one is regulating. You've seen tomatoes with those yellowish powder. People just buy and eat.
I know. Robert, we seem to be running out, rather David, we seem to be running out of time. But before you go, I wanted us to talk about the exports. There's a report that shows that about 43% of our food is exported, especially in the region. Do you think in a way it has contributed to food insecurity? Just briefly as we wrap up.
No, it doesn't contribute to food insecurity. In fact, we should encourage small-scale farmers to grow more food for their consumption. And then you find that if someone is growing food for sale, they always have food in their households. So the issue is not that. The issue is failure on the part of government to make sure that food goes to places where there is scarcity and maybe regulate wastage at points where there is plenty.
All right. Thank you very much, David Kabanda, for sharing with us, you know, the insights.
You're welcome.
And of course, you know, as a Ugandan, I think you have picked, you know, a word or two about food insecurity. You know, we need to grow this food to make sure that our food is secure from food insecurity. And of course, you know, thank you very much for joining us.
Yeah.
And of course, to the rest of the Ugandans, wish you a very, you know, happy food day.
Yeah.
And we're going to stop for a break right now. When we come, we're going to the entertainment news. Keep it up.